तो आएंगे बस आएंगे अपने अपने।
हाय हेमंक, हाउ आर यू? सो स्टडीज गोइंग वेल? सो व्हेन आर यू हैविंग योर हाफ ईयरली एग्जाम्स? सेवनटीन्थ ऑफ सितंबर, राइट? ओके, एंड व्हाट इज द सिलेबस that you are getting? Not yet confirmed. Any chances of rotational motion? Okay. You have done that in your school? That is a pretty tough chapter. Interesting too. Have you done, I have asked that, have you done rotational motion in your school? No. Partially it can come, that means, not complete. And what about Mithun? When are you having your half yearly exams? September? Bhavil? Yeah, quarterly. September should be half yearly. Yeah. And syllabus? half yearly is in the month of December. It's too late. And Feb or March, after 2 months, you will be having full yearly. Eh? So December is not supposed to be half yearly. But anyways, that's your school's decision. And what are the chapters that you are coming? Tell me the last chapter. That means if it is still work per energy, that means you are covering all the chapters till work per energy. System of particles and rotational motion. How do you find this chapter, rotational motion? Interesting or tough? The whole chapter is tricky. Which part is not tricky? Moment of inertia, yeah, it's a tricky topic. And what about center of mass? Have you done that? Okay, that also depends that what type of questions have you have done. Basically, in school, we take a very general type of questions. So, this is also an issue. Center of mass is the very first chapter in this chapter. Very first topic. If you haven't done center of mass till now, that means they will not take this article. So, Bhavil, you are back again. That means they will skip the article. Where have you gone, Bhavil? You were here, then you disconnected, then you came back. Very good evening. So, Mithun, how do you find this article projectile motion? This is also a bit, this is also a tricky article. Not like kinematics. Okay. Have you gone through the videos that are on the website? You have watched all the videos, Mithun? Hemant, you have also watched all the videos? Four. On problem solving. Last week you have watched all of them, eh? Then you must have watched projectile motion on an inclined plane also. That is a quite different type of article. Hi, Karan. Yeah, it's a bit confusing. Basically, we have shift done by a method in which shift our axis. We have shifted our x and y axis, this coordinate system. Generally, what we do, we don't take any coordinates. We take acceleration along x-axis as zero. But when we take shift our coordinate, the acceleration is no more zero along x-axis. So we do have a component of gravity along x-axis. That's why it got trickier. So, Karan, when are you having your half yearly exams? See, one thing I would like to share. You must maintain your focus on this competitive part. The school exams are not that important as we take it. We must not leave any session due to our school exams. So this is even important. Our focus must be very clear. Any of you will be giving SAT also? To study abroad after 12th? Okay. So, what do you want to study and where do you want to study after the SAT exam, Karan? SAT is basically an exam that is in which you get some bands and you can go abroad to study in Western countries. MIT or IBIS. You need to have a very polished English. You need to write essays and all that. This is what I know. I don't know very much about the pattern, but this is at least I know about this. So, Samaksh and Karan have talked to others and Parul. What about this midterm exams? You are also having them in September? From 7 September. And Karan, what about you? Parul? That's good. IIT should be our primary focus, that should be our secondary. This is how we should proceed. This is the right thing, right technique of proceeding. Let's see who else have joined us. And Sumit. Sumit, this is your first session? Good evening, Ravisha. This is your first session, is it? With me? And what about Sumit? Okay, I think we should start. If you have watched yes, sure, Samaksh, you can ask. By calculating the speed of a motorbike to cross a ditch, range is 11. We must consider the length of a bike also, right? Definitely, we should consider the length of a bike. The total in that case, if the length of ditch is, the length of bike is given in the question? Was that given in the question? No, then how can we consider that? We have to take that as a point object. If the length of bike is given, should have if it's given in the question, then we'll add the length of bike with this range 11.7 feet. Let us say the length of bike is 5 feet, then 11.7 plus 5, the total range required to be taken is 16.7 feet. Ana, ek minute. An illustration to page 9, T1 equal to T2. Let me open the page number 9, then I will talk about this. Okay. Maximum height is same. Not U, not theta. In this case, maximum height is same. I'll take this. I'll definitely take this example. You have to wait. My pen is not working. We have taken initial plus final divided by 2 because the motion is uniformly accelerated. I'll take that. I was thinking on the same lines. I'll definitely take this concept when and how, where we should take initial plus final divided by 2 and where we should avoid this. ओ गुड इवनिंग आर्यन। ना टुडे यू आर ऑन टाइम। पेन नहीं चल रहा देखना। सो आर्यन रस्तोगु इज ऑन टाइम टुडे। नाइस टू सी यू। This is a very good example illustration, page number 9, question number 9. Very good illustration. In average velocity, why vertical velocity is same in magnitude? I didn't understood your question as well. Vertical component of velocity changes. We cannot say it is same in magnitude. In this question number 9, you are asking. Where, in which question, Ujjwal? You remember the question? Is that question from your module? Because I have covered all the questions, I think, from your module. Good evening, Ayush. Ujjwal, is that question from your module? When you told about average vertical projection, I don't remember actually, because that is a very old video. I have done that, I think, a month ago. So it is very difficult for me to remember. The question I solved in a video a month back. Yes, Amaksha, I am taking this. I am taking this question. My pen actually is not working. So, I have asked someone to look into it. So, make average velocity projection. It's projectile motion, but then always you are saying average velocity in projectile motion. Average velocity in projectile motion, okay. I have taken two questions. The one I have found average in case of horizontal projectile, the other average in case of vertical projectile. Right. In angular projection, the vertical component remains same because they are at same height. The projectile motion follows symmetry. So if I draw a line from the center, like say this is the projectile motion, and from the center, if I draw a line, we can say this motion towards left is same as motion towards right. So it's a symmetrical motion about a line passing through the highest point perpendicular to the plane. So if the particle is at same height, it must have same velocity, both same initial, so same vertical component of velocity and horizontal component. Angles will also be same, the magnitude of velocity will also be same. I'll take the full concept in today's session, complete, of average velocity, and we'll be taking projectile motion on an inclined plane also. These two articles we'll take in today's session. Circular motion we will take in next class, not today. We will dedicate a complete class to circular motion, and then after that we will take a doubt session also. If in case you will be requiring, we will keep a class for doubts also after the completion of circular motion. Now the pen is working, we can write, we can start. Okay. Now this is a question that we were talking about. X-axis, my y-axis, then this is a first projectile motion. And this is your second projectile motion. We have two different types of projectile motion. Let us say this is projected with velocity u1 at an angle theta 1. And the red one is projected with velocity u2 at an angle theta 2. From here, this dotted line, we can see the maximum height attained by first body is equal to maximum height attained by second. The formula is u square sine square theta upon 2g. In second case, it is u2 square sine square theta 2 upon 2g again. This gets cancelled out. So what you get, u1 sine theta 1, it is equal to u2 sine theta 2. Fine. Now, time of flight, it is 2u sine theta upon g. In first case, time of flight is 2u1 sine theta 1 upon g. In second case, time of flight is 2u2 sine theta 2 upon g. So since u sine theta is same in both the cases, these are same in both the cases, so we can say T1 is equal to T2. फाइन समक्ष ओके Ujjwal, I didn't understood your question. Because here from you can see this is the case of time of light. This is okay. The maximum height is same, but I am not saying that. What I am saying, this maximum height H1 in this case and the maximum attained by the second body is same. These two heights are same. So if these two heights are same, the product of u and sine theta, u1 sine theta 1 equal to u2 sine theta 2. Fine? It's u2 sine theta 2. So type of light, it is proportional to u sine theta. Since the factor u sine theta in both the cases is same, so we can say T1 is equal to T2. It is as simple, because U1 sine theta 1 equal to U2 sine theta 2, so we can say 2U1 sine theta 1 by G equal to 2U2 sine theta 2 by G, so T1 is equal to T2. Fine. Now, let's move on to the concept of average velocity. We have taken two different scenarios. We have projected a body with velocity u at an angle theta with the horizontal, fine. Now, average velocity, we have two formulas for average velocity. The one is total displacement upon total time. The other is u plus v, of course, vector addition divided by 2. This formula we'll be using for uniformly accelerated motion only, when acceleration A is constant. So in this case, we can say here the component along x-axis ux is u cos theta, and the component along y-axis is u sin theta. Here g is constant, right? Here that g is vertically downward and it is constant. Now, the concept that I was talking about, that this is a vertical line. This along about this vertical line, the motion is towards left is same as motion towards right. So this motion is highly symmetrical. So this point and this point, they are at same height, same level. So velocity u, angle theta will also be same. U cos theta, u sin theta. This is due to symmetry. Right, Ujjwal? This is due to symmetrical conditions. Now, we can take two different things. The one, if I say average velocity is total displacement upon total time, so displacement from this point is a range. This is my range, R, divided by time taken, that is equal to time of flight. So range here is u square sine 2 theta upon g, and your time of flight is 2u sine theta by g. Here gg gets cancelled out. U square also gets cancelled out. Now u sine 2 theta is 2 sine theta cos theta, and in the denominator we have 2 sine theta. So 2 sine theta, 2 sine theta, this gets cancelled out, and you get u cos theta. This is the first method. Alternatively, I have done this question through another method also, that average velocity calculated along x-axis, initial is u cos theta, final is u cos theta divided by 2, that is 2u cos theta divided by 2, that is u cos theta. Further, the calculation of average velocity about y-axis is u sin theta. Here I have u sin theta along positive. This u sin theta final is along negative. So it's minus u sin theta upon 2. So it becomes 0. Acceleration is 0 in horizontal. Since acceleration is 0 is horizontal, so but acceleration is constant. It's 0 acceleration, a constant acceleration, or a variable acceleration? It is constant throughout. It is 0 throughout. It is constant throughout. We are concerned with the term constant. It should be constant. Now here, if I solve it further, I can write that my average velocity is v average along x square, v average along y square under root. So it's u square cos square theta plus 0 square under root. So it's u cos theta. So I can take both the scenarios, I can take both the cases. You can note it down, then we'll take a case of horizontal projectile. Find we have taken divided by 2, we have already divided it by 2 in this case. Now when we have calculated average along x-axis and average along y-axis, then the resultant will be calculated by this formula, y2 divided by 2. See, here we have divided by it by 2, we have divided it by 2. Along y-axis also we have divided it by 2. Fine. Should I proceed to next question? Now let's take a case of, we'll calculate the same average in case of horizontal projection . This is a tower whose height is, let us say, h. And we have projected a body with velocity u horizontally from here. It falls on the ground at this point. Fine. In this case, we have to calculate average velocity first by using formula average velocity is total displacement upon total time, and then it's total displacement upon total time. And then by using, then we'll use it another formula, that is initial plus final velocity divided by 2. And we'll verify the results that are coming from both the cases is same. Fine. So I'm giving you 2-3 minutes time. You take your 2-3-4-5 minutes time, you do it, and then we'll go for the calculation part. Fine. So, Anag, you have joined late today. Deepika has joined us for the first time, right? Okay, this is a case of horizontal projectile. We have projected a body horizontally, right? So we'll calculate that, we have to calculate the average velocity first by using this formula, secondly by using initial plus final divided by 2. So we'll be doing it through two different methods, because we have to learn both the methods. We don't have to restrict ourselves on a single method. We'll be doing it with two different methods, with both the methods.
Coffee is good.
We have a coffee making expert in our office. Are you doing it? Trying it? Okay, great. Okay. Let's do it by first method, that is, it is total displacement upon total time. From the formula x, we know it is u under root of 2h upon g. This is a formula for range. So the displacement, that is straight line joining initial and final point, is my displacement. So displacement here is h square plus x square under root, that is u square 2h upon g. This is x square h square under root. Time of flight is under root of 2h upon g. So average velocity from first method is displacement upon time of flight, u square 2h upon g upon h square divided by time of flight, that is two h upon g. So it comes out to be u square under root of 2h upon g, and 2h upon g is cancelled out. Plus h square 2h upon g. So what you get? It's u square h g divided by 2 under root. Fine. Now you do the same question, proceed the same question from second method. Initial plus final divided by 2. Should I do or you want to try? Yes, Hemang, Mithun, Ujwal, Samaks, Ayush, Deepak, okay. Sure. You give it a try. Done, Samaks, good. So we should proceed. Using the concept of initial plus final velocity divided by 2. The initial velocity is this velocity with which we have projected our body. This is u I cap. Here also, if we don't go on into this part of I cap, when the body reaches here, it will have the same x component, whereas the y component will be different, it will change. Vy is uy plus ay into t, uy is 0, ay is gravity g, and t is your time of flight, that is 2h upon g. So it's 2hg under root. Now, average velocity along x-axis, initial is u, final is u, divided by 2, that's u. Initial is u, final is u. Here, uy is 0. If we talk about average velocity along y-axis, the initial velocity of 0. Because at this point of projection, the velocity velocity is 100% completely dedicated towards x-axis. It has no y component, so it's useless to talk about y component. That is zero over here. And at this point, when it hits the ground, the y component is 2hg under root of 2hg initial plus final divided by 2 along y. So it's hg by 2 under root. Now my complete average is my average along x-axis square plus average along y-axis square divided square root. So it's u square plus hg by 2 under root. So we see that this result and this result from both the methods, they are exactly the same, no difference. But sometimes we get here you can also see, sometimes we get this result by using a particular method by some easier means, right? You want to note it down, or should I proceed to next article? You can take a snapshot or whatever you do. Now let's consider a case of projectile motion on an inclined plane. Bit tricky, bit difficult, and interesting also. So we can take two different cases. When a body is projected upward or when it is projected in the downward direction. That is, let us say this is inclined plane with angle beta. Sure. I'll switch to previous board, then I'll come back to it. If you want to note it down, you can do it. Do inform me when you have noted down. Jagishan, do inform me when you note it. Sure. I think we should understand the concept first. You have projected this body at an angle alpha with the ground. So the angle which a body is making with the inclined plane is alpha minus beta. Now, what we do here, the component of velocity along the inclined plane, what I am doing, I am taking this axis as my x-axis, and the axis which is perpendicular to this as my y-axis. So this is my x-axis and this is my y-axis. So if I take the component ux of velocity and this is uy. In this case, ux is u cos alpha minus beta. And uy is u sin alpha minus beta. Here, this is the direction of acceleration g, vertically downward. Fine. But if I take this as my x-axis and this as my y-axis, so this angle is perpendicular, this line is perpendicular to this line is perpendicular to this, so this angle will be beta. This will be the direction of gravity along y-axis, and this is the component of gravity along x-axis. Both will be negative. So, acceleration along x-axis is minus g sine beta, and acceleration along y-axis is minus g cos beta. Fine. This is g cos beta, and this is g sine beta. We have taken it negative because these are along the negative x and y axis respectively. Now, if you make an equation of y coordinate, so y displacement is u y t plus half a y t square. So the value of u y is u sine alpha minus beta. It's u sine alpha minus beta into t minus half g, because a y is minus g cos beta, g cos beta into t square. Now here if I put my y displacement equal to 0 to calculate total time of flight, I'll have to substitute y displacement equal to 0 to calculate total time of flight, because total time of flight, y displacement will be equal to 0 at this point. At this point. Moreover, in this case, the motion will not be symmetrical about its highest point, because it would be symmetrical if the motion would have ended at this point, not here. It has ended at some intermediate level. Now, if I put it equal to 0, so what I get? Half g cos beta into t square, that's t, equal to u sine alpha minus beta into t. So this t gets cancelled out. So we get t equal to 2u sine alpha minus beta. It's 2u sin alpha minus beta upon g cos beta. So this is your time of flight. Although it is not required to remember this time of flight. And further, if I substitute the value of this time of flight in my x distance, I'll get the expression for range. So my x coordinate, x distance is uxt plus half axt square. You can see it from here. The value of ux is u cos alpha minus beta. This is u cos alpha minus beta into t plus half ax. Ax is g sine beta. It's negative, of course. It's negative g sine beta. So we'll take this sine as negative into t square. Now, if I substitute the value of t from the above mentioned relation at this point, so I'll be getting the value of range because this is my total time of flight. Now, it's u cos alpha minus beta t 2u sine alpha minus beta upon g cos beta minus half g sine beta into t square. T square is 4 u square sine square alpha minus beta upon g square cos square beta. Fine. If you will be calculating this part, you will be getting the expression for your range. But I repeat, remembering this expression for range is not mandatory. You can directly remember this expression. I am not going into the lengthier calculation because the calculation will be a bit lengthier. So I am directly writing the result. You can solve it. It's cos alpha upon g cos square beta. Further, I'll also write that range is maximum when alpha equal to pi by 4 plus beta by 2. The maximum we can get by differentiating this range with respect to angle of inclination, because beta is constant with respect to alpha, and by substituting it equal to 0. And the maximum value of this range is u square upon g 1 plus sine beta. If in case you forget these formulas, so there is no need to worry, because we can directly draw this diagram, use these terms. And by general equation of motion, we can solve directly whatever is required in the question. We can solve it directly. Now you want to note it down? Do note it down if you want to, then we'll proceed. And do inform me also after noting it down. Okay. I don't think you will be requiring these formulas. It's totally up to you. You can solve the numericals by using these formulas, and you can do it directly also. Let's take an example. We'll solve it without using these formulas, right? This angle is 30 degree. I have projected a body at an angle 60 degree with the ground with velocity 20 meter per second. So calculate the time of flight range and maximum height attained also. Time of flight range and maximum height attained. Samaksh, it is very similar to the case when we calculate the maximum range in terms of when we talk about maximum range wala part in case of oblique or angular projectile. We take the maximum range when theta is equal to 45 degree and we do it by directly substituting sine to theta equal to 1. In this case, we cannot do so because the final figure is a product of sine function and cos function. So we have to differentiate the function with respect to variable and put it equal to 0. So after going into the calculation further involved, which is further involved, you can get the result of maximum range, condition for maximum range. Okay, let's proceed. So this is our question. You have to calculate time of flight. You have to calculate time of flight, range, and maximum height attained. So time of flight, okay, let's now do it without using any formulas, fine. You can use the formula directly, but let's now do it without using any formula. Let's take the components of respective velocity and acceleration. This angle is 30 degree. So ux is 20 cos 30. 20 cos 30 is 20. Cos 30 is root 3 by 2. So it's 10 root 3. This is uy, which is 20 sin 30, which is equal to 10. This is g. This angle is 30. So it's g cos 30 root 3 g by 2, and this is g sin 30, that is g by 2. Now the x coordinate is ux into t plus half ax into t square. So my ux, this is my ux, tan root 3 into t minus half ax is g root 3 by 2. Of course it is negative, that is why I have taken this negative sign over here, into t square. And for my time of flight, let's put x coordinate equal to 0, because my at this point, I am repeating it again, because at this point, when this body completes its project motion, this point, this is my x coordinate. My x coordinate is 0 at this point, and it is 0 at this point. So let's further solve it. If I put it equal to 0, so what I get, g, that is 10, let's take g as 10, root 3, 2 to the 4 into t square equal to 10 root 3 into t, 10 root 3, 10 root 3 gets cancelled out, I have taken g as equal to 10, so t and this t and this square gets cancelled out, so we get t equal to 4 seconds. So time of flight here is 4 seconds. Further, if I put this time of flight back extremely sorry, I have to take a y coordinate as equal to 0 at this point. So I'll have to take y coordinate equal to 0. Y is u by t plus half a by t square. This point has a coordinate origin 0, 0, and this point has a coordinate r, 0, because y coordinate is 0. Let's put y equal to 0, uy is 10 here, t, ay is g root 3 by 2, it's half g root 3 by 2 into t square. So it's g, let's take g as equal to 10, 10 root 3 by 4 into t square is 10 t, here t gets cancelled out, 10 also gets cancelled out, so time of flight is 4 upon root 3 seconds. Aren't 4 upon root 3, it's 4 upon root 3. So time of flight is 4 upon root 3 seconds. Now, if I substitute the value of this time of flight here, we know to range, x coordinate is ux into t plus half ax into t square, and if I substitute the value of this time of flight in this equation of x coordinate, so this is, as this is a total time, total time of flight, so we'll get the equation, we'll get what we get, the maximum distance traveled. So it's my range. So range, that is ux, so ux we can see, we can write it from here, ux is equal to 10 root 3, we have calculated it over here in this figure. So ux is 10 root 3, time of flight is 4 upon root 3 minus half, ax here is g by 2 is 10 by 2, 5, into t square, t is 4 upon root 3 square. Now let's solve it. We have substituted the values from the diagram. Now if I solve it, what I get? This gets cancelled out. So I get this sum is 40 minus 5 upon 2, 16 upon 3, 8. So it's 40, 5, 8 is 40 by 3, 120 minus 40 by 3, it's 80 upon 3 meter. And for maximum height attained, let me use this space, as from here I can directly visualize the diagram and take the data required from Now, at this maximum height, this is the point of maximum height. At this point, the velocity is parallel to ground. So this maximum height, in this case, I can directly apply the formula u square sin square theta upon 2g. To calculate maximum height, I can directly use this formula. Because the velocity is parallel to ground, so this height can be calculated from the ground. So this you can do. U is the initial velocity, that is 20. It's 20 square sin theta. Theta is the angle that you take with the ground. So it's sin square 60 divided by 2 into g 20. You can solve it to get your 20 sin 60 is root 3 by 2 square, it's 5 root 3 meter. All right, sure. I'm giving you mic access. Yes, Aryan, now you can speak. Aryan, I have granted you mic access. Now you can speak.
If you want to calculate the height in accordance to the inclined plane.
Speak a bit louder, better.
How can we calculate if we want to calculate the height in accordance to the inclined plane?
From the inclined plane. Sure. You can calculate. If you want to calculate this height from an inclined plane, this is the height, right? This is the distance from the inclined plane. Fine. Now, this is your distance r by 2, range divided by 2. If I talk about the complete projectile motion, if
sir, you could. Sir, not this. I'm asking the highest height in the inclined plane itself.
Yeah, this point.
The inclined plane.
This point, no? This is the height on the
highest height in. Yes, sir. Highest height on the inclined plane only.
This point, if you take this height as equal to y, you can calculate it because we have calculated this range. Range is this distance from this point to this point. Now this angle is theta. You can calculate this coordinate y by using the geometry, by the trigonometry, sorry. Sin 30 is y upon r. You can directly use the formula sin 30 equal to sin 30 equal to y divided by r. So your why?
Sir, not that high, sir. Sir,
Which point you are
I'm
talking? This
asking
point?
about the.
Or this
Sir,
point?
it's
Point number
like,
one or point number two?
the highest height of inclined plane. Sir, can I write it
Highest
on
height
board?
of
Is it
inclined
possible?
plane doesn't mean anything. What do you mean by highest height of inclined plane?
Sir, can I write anything on board?
Yeah, sure. You can write. I'll give you grant access. Now.
This.
Okay, this one. Because this is perpendicular, you are talking about perpendicular to inclined plane, fine? Yeah,
Yes,
you
sir.
can.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. No. Now, if you want to calculate this at this point, we'll go accordingly as per the situation we were previously going through this. Okay, let me. This is very becomes a very bad diagram now. At this point, the velocity component, this is the component of velocity. Direction, if I draw a tangent, tangent will be parallel to plane. So if the tangent at this point, the velocity is parallel to my inclined plane, then I can take the y component of velocity equal to zero, whereas my y-axis is this is my y-axis. So Vy equal to uy plus ay into t. If I take Vy is 0, and what is my uy? This is my uy. Then ay is this is g root 3 by 2. Into t. So from this I get a time from which it will cover, it will reach this point, and then I can calculate the y distance by substituting this value in this equation of y-axis. This equation of y-axis. From this equation, if I substitute the value of this time in this y-axis, I get this height. Fine. Now, let's move on to one more question. Let me change the data. We'll take a similar type of question. This is 75 degree and velocity u is 10 root 3. Yeah, we'll find it. In this case, if we talk about this case, in Aryan's question, let me write it first. Those who have understood that point can solve this question. Others, for others, I'll explain them. In this scenario, you have to calculate time of flight, range, and maximum height. Leave it for this case. Okay. The question that Aryan has asked is how to calculate this height. This is a perpendicular distance. Now, time taken by part projectile from this point to this point, we can calculate by using the formula Vy equal to Uy plus Ay into t. Because at this point, I am considering this as my x-axis, and that here my velocity is parallel to x-axis, so my y component will become zero. If I put Vy equal to 0, Uy we know it's equal to 10. Acceleration along y axis is g root 3 by 2 into t. We have substituted it. If I put equal to 0, so I'll get the value of time, that is 10 root 3 divided by 2 into t equal to 10. This gets cancelled out, so t you get equal to 2 upon root 3. If you substitute the value of this t in this equation of, this is my y coordinate, so I'll get this y displacement in this equation. You substitute and get the value. Fine? Now let's move on to another question. Here comes the question. You take your time and calculate range and maximum height, but without using formula, direct formula. Direct formula you can apply anytime, but that will not build your concept. For the calculation of time, we have to, let's take ux. This angle is 45 degrees. So it's u cos 45. Ux is u cos 45. U is 10 root 3. Cos 45 is 1 upon, sorry, it this should be root 10 root 2. You should take it as 10 root 2. Extremely sorry, this will, if you take the data as root 2, it will, so it's 10 meter per second. Whereas my uy is u, that is 10 root 2 sine 45. It will also be equal to 10. For the calculation of g, this component is g y. So g y is a y or g y is g sine, sorry, cos. It's g cos 30. 10 root 3 by 2, so it's 5 root 3. Acceleration along x direction, this is 10 sine 30, which is equal to 5, because sine 30 is 1 upon 2. Now y is 2 plus half a y t square, and we have to put y equal to 0 for the calculation of time. U y is 10 into t minus half, ay is 5 root 3 into t square. So 5 root 3 upon 2 into t square, it is equal to 10 t. t gets cancelled out. So you get time of flight equal to 2 into 10, 20 divided by 5 root 3. So it's 4 upon root 3 seconds. So it's 4 upon root 3 seconds. Now we can calculate the value of range. Likewise, the calculation of range is ux into total time of flight plus half ax into t square. Now ux we have calculated equal to 10. Time of flight is 4 upon root 3 half ax is 5 into t square, that is 16 upon 3. You can calculate it to get the value of range. Now let's do the this same question in a reverse manner. Let's consider the same data, 30 degree. We have projected a body with a velocity of 10 root 2 meter per second at a point somewhere here. Here the angle with the inclined plane, you take it as 45 degree. Consider this angle as 45. Now calculate time of flight and range. Fine. Draw the components and solve it accordingly. you give 2-3 minutes time to it, then I'll do it for you. First you try it. You keep on solving. I'm just drawing the components. Ux equal to, this is 10 root 2 cos 45, 10 Uy is also 10. Let's talk about acceleration. G, this is gy or ay, it is g cos 30 10 root 3 by 2 5 root 3, and this component AX is G sine 30, which is 5. Now this will be, motion will be like this. To calculate time of light, you have to proceed in a very similar way, that the y component will become zero. And y, what is the y? That is uyt plus half ay into t square. So if I put y component will be equal to 0, so it will be 0 at time t equal to 0 and at my total time of flight. That is uy is 10 into t, ay is 5 root 3, but you will take it as negative. It's minus 5 root 3 by 2 because it's along negative y-axis. It's 2 is for half from here into t square. So you get 5 root 3 upon 2 t square equal to 10 t. So t comes out to be 4 upon root 3 seconds. Do remember to take sign conventions Very good, Samaksh. Very good. And this range, for the calculation of this range, my x displacement, that is my range, it's ux into total time of flight plus half acceleration along acceleration into total time of flight square. Now ux is 10 into my total time of flight, which is 4 upon root 3 minus half acceleration along acceleration. Sorry, in this case, do consider this ux is negative. This ux is negative, it is minus 10. Ax is minus 5. So negative sign is for minus 5 into 4 t square, which is 6 upon 16 upon 3. 4 root 3 ka square is 16 upon 3. So it's minus 40 upon root 3 minus 40 upon 3. So you take 3 as LCM. Minus 40, you can take common. So it's root 3 plus 1. This is your range. Do remember to consider sign conventions correctly. Otherwise, you will lie in a trap and you won't be able to solve it. Fine? Now, let's take one more question. Here you have this angle is beta. U. This angle is alpha. So see, this is how a projectile hits the plane. It hits the ground, it hits the inclined plane perpendicular, 90 degree. It is given to us. Fine. If it hits the plane at 90 degree, you have to show that, you have to prove cot beta is equal to 2 tan alpha minus beta. Fine. Now, again you take 5 minutes time and solve it. Okay, see here we have two things. We can move with two things. First, I have time of flight, the equation for time of flight, because the motion projectile has completed its total tenure. It completed has completed its journey. So my time of flight is, I am writing here the direct formula, sine alpha minus beta upon g cos beta. This is the direct formula for time of flight, right? The other thing that I have is here at the time when this particle hits back the ground, hits back the incline, its component of velocity along x-axis is zero. It is parallel to y-axis. So when it hits the ground, its vx, which is of course ux plus ax into t, this is equal to 0. Now what is my ux? Ux is the component of velocity along this direction. That is u cos, the angle with incline is alpha minus beta. So it's u cos alpha minus beta plus ax. This is my g cos beta. This is g sine beta. So I'll take ax equal to g sine beta. So it's minus of course, I'll take it as negative because it's along negative x direction. It's g sine beta into t square. And if I put it equal to 0, because my vx is 0, so what I get, t is equal to u cos alpha minus beta upon, I'll take it in the denominator, g sine beta. These are the only two things that I can derive. I cannot derive any get anything apart from this. Further, if I equate this time with this time, because these two times are for the entire journey. So if I equate them, that time t is equal to 2u sine alpha minus beta upon g cos beta equal to u cos alpha minus beta upon g sine beta. U gets cancelled out, g gets cancelled out. So you get 2 sine alpha minus beta upon cos beta is cos, sorry, I have to take it in the denominator, upon cos alpha minus beta, let's take it up, cos beta upon sine beta. So from here you get your desired result, that is 2 tan alpha minus beta equal to cot beta. Fine. You can note it down. After this, you have your booklets with them in the booklets. Question number 20, page number 26, question number 24. You have your VMC. Next question is from your VMC booklet. That's question number 24, page number 26. If there is someone who don't have this booklet, do let me know. I'll explain the question, I'll read the question, I'll write the question for you. Otherwise, again, you take your 5 minutes time and solve it. Who is not the answer? I'll write a question for you. This is 10 meters per second, and this is 60 degrees. Find complete angle with the ground. You have to calculate time after which velocity becomes parallel to incline. Time after which the velocity becomes parallel to incline. So this is the question. Nitya, now you have got the question? Okay. You might be having some other booklet, some other edition. You might be having the latest edition. I am having the previous year booklet. Fine. Now, we have to tell the velocity time after which the velocity becomes parallel to the incline. It is a very similar type of question that Aryan has asked. This time after which this velocity becomes parallel to my x-axis. This is my x-axis, this is my y-axis. At this point, my Vy, y component is 0. So I can calculate this velocity Vy by substituting Uy plus Ay into t equal to 0. Fine? Do it fast. No, it's not. It's 1 upon root 3. The answer is 1 upon root 3. Check your solution, check your calculation, and then revert back. Check the sign conventions. Most important part, check the sign conventions of U and A that you have taken. Very good, Aryan. Now you have got the point. Eh? This was the same point that you were discussing. At this point, the velocity is parallel to incline. So it's along x-axis. My Vy axis is y-coordinate is 0. Uy, this angle is 30 degree with the incline. So Uy is U sine 30. U is 10. So it's 10 sine 30. Ay, this is G. This is G cos 30. Ay is G cos 30. You will take it as negative because it's along negative y direction. So it's minus 10 cos 30 into t. You put it equal to 0, you get 10 cos 30 root 3 upon 2 into t equal to 10 sin 30 1 upon 2. So t becomes equal to 1 upon root 3 seconds. Fine. So this was a nice question. Now, before It's minus because the component of acceleration is along negative y-axis. This is negative y-axis. This is positive y-axis. And this is negative. How can time be in minus? Time cannot be negative. Let's do one more question and then we'll sum up the session. A body is projected with velocity v u at an angle theta with the ground. When the body is at highest point, this is the highest point, you have to tell the radius of the circle. A small part of an arc can be considered as straight line. Here, let's consider this a small arc, and if I draw a circle from here, you have to calculate radius r of the circle. Radius r of this circle. Radius r of this circle, which the arc at the highest point is making. Okay, the basic concept is, I'll come to the concept and then I'll solve this question. It's not h upon 2. Here, the velocity is parallel to the ground. This is my velocity. The component ux is u cos theta. Here, whatever the velocity I have, v, of course, it will be equal to u cos theta at this point, because the at this point, I am having my horizontal component only and no vertical component. And this velocity will be a centripetal. This gives you centripetal acceleration. And it will move in a circular path only when the force towards the center, right now is this case is mg for a body, and the centrifugal force mv square upon r balances out. Then only we can draw conclude a circle at this point. So if I write mv square upon r equal to mg, mm gets cancelled out. Now v square is u square cos square theta. V square is u square cos square theta upon r. It becomes equal to g. So radius is u square cos square theta upon r. Upon G. Fine. Before concluding, I would like to add on one more point. If we'll be finding out the arc circle at some intermediate point, so that intermediate point, that velocity will be like this. So centrifugal force mv square by r must be perpendicular to this velocity. Now we have to calculate the value of velocity if I'm talking about this. Now mg is in this direction. The component of gravity, let us say this angle is theta, alpha, sorry. The component of gravity at this angle, which is against mv square by r, is mg cos alpha. So mg cos alpha must balance out centrifugal force at this point, then only we can say the body can move in circular motion. So by solving, going into this calculation, I can calculate the radius of curvature at any instantaneous point. This is a calculation for any instantaneous point. One of an example of this case is given to you in your Vidya Mandir booklets. In solved example, I'll tell you the page number. It's page number, example number 4, page 20 for instantaneous. It's example 4, page 20. You can go through it. I have given you the concept. The concept is like the instantaneous value of velocity will give me centrifugal force, and the component of gravity, weight of the particle at that point, must balance out my centrifugal force to give me the value of radius of curvature at that point. So this was all about today's session. Thank you very much. It was